It's my honor to introduce tonight's keynote speaker, Lisa Shalett. Lisa is a retired Goldman Sachs partner, having worked a 20-year career at Goldman, including over five divisions. She was most recently the global head of brand marketing and digital strategy in the executive office, and previously the global COO of compliance, legal, and internal audit. After leaving Goldman, Lisa had a, as she calls it, a failed retirement and joined the executive team at Odyssey, an explosively growing millennials-focused media platform, as the CMO and advisor. It is my honor, and please join me in welcoming Lisa Shalett.
Thank you. You said that was going to be short, and it was. It is a tremendous honor to be here with all of you tonight. I will do my best to, I guess, justify my existence up here, and thank you very much, Nick and team. There are so many things that I could stand up here and talk to you about, but what I've tried to do is I've kind of eavesdropped on a few sessions and listened to some conversations during cocktail hour is really think about how I could share a few things from my strange career that hopefully will resonate. And just to give you a little bit more background, lest you think my career was well planned out, I got to Wall Street because I speak Japanese. I have a Japan background. Never in my wildest dreams did I imagine that there was a job that would pay me to talk to smart people about Japan all day, and yet it exists. So I did that first at Barclays and then at Goldman. And that was how I started on Wall Street. Thankfully, Goldman and Barclays were willing to teach me about markets. And in that capacity, I had a very interesting 11 years, made partner in the equities division. For a while, I was the only woman partner in the equities division, which in and of itself was interesting. And therefore, I never thought that they were going to let me out of the equities division because they needed women partners in the equities division. So imagine my surprise as I was heading international equities sales and trading. Everything was going along just fine. When the then head of the securities division called me into his office and said, "Lisa, I need you to do me a solid." I'm like, "What's that?" He said, "I need you to go become the chief operating officer of global compliance." And I said, "What? What and why?" Because again, like, had I lifted my head up and imagined myself doing something in a different division at Goldman, that wouldn't have been at the top of my list. Not so much because I think poorly of compliance officers. I relied on them tremendously. How can you get anything done without good compliance officers? But you know, I imagined that division, that role, to be one where you have a lot of subject matter experts. And who was I to be dropped amongst all of these subject matter experts? Yet, when we had a further discussion on the why and how did you get this crazy idea, are you exiling me, he had a really interesting answer. And that was, at the end of 2005, when this conversation occurred, it was just before things were about to go pretty interesting as far as the financial markets and crisis were concerned. And as he looked at the firm, he saw that the new growth areas of the firm were not going to be the revenue businesses. They were going to be the control functions. And let's take someone who has experience running a revenue business and a growth mindset and drop them into these supposedly non-revenue areas and run them like businesses. When he said it like that, that sounded like an amazing challenge. And you know, it's funny, just to pause on that for a moment, everybody thought I was crazy for leaving a revenue seat to go into compliance of all things. And if you listen to everybody in those circumstances, you might underestimate roles that actually become phenomenal platforms if you learn to look at them that way. So not only was it interesting to bring a different perspective, a revenue perspective, into a non-revenue, I hate that term, non-revenue area like that, isn't it interesting to be a business trained person in a sea of subject matter experts. What's going to happen with that alchemy? And then compliance is one of those not only critical functions within an investment bank for sure, but one that touches every business of the firm everywhere in the world. And so if you're looking to learn about everything the firm does, that kind of seat is an incredibly valuable seat. And so people thought I was crazy, but I said, bring it on. And so I showed up in the beginning of 2006 as the Chief Operating Officer of Global Compliance, working for a brilliant former defense attorney and former prosecutor who had walked into the firm at this very senior level running compliance at Goldman Sachs, walked right onto management committee, so hadn't had to work his way up through the ranks to get there, a place where few people get. And maybe in the course of his career had managed teams of 10. And here he was managing what started off as a team of 500 globally and then grew to 650 plus all over the world, including opening up an office in Bangalore. And so, we were a very interesting pair. And my goal was to have compliance be as well known for how it ran as a business as it was for the expertise that made it compliance. And there was a lot that I learned in bringing a business and revenue mindset to all of these subject matter experts that I'll talk about in a moment, because I think that those skills are very relevant to some of the things that all of you sound like you're encountering right now. Anyway, in addition to compliance, I was also given COO responsibilities eventually for the legal department. Let's try being an MBA in the legal department, and audit as well. And those also proved to be fascinating experiences at a very interesting time. Bear Stearns blew up, Lehman blew up, Goldman and other firms became bank holding companies. There were so many ways in which, if compliance were central to things before, it was even more so with regulators living with us, and some of you may have experienced some of these things in your career in different shapes and forms. But that was an incredible way to learn. After 4.5 years of doing that, though, I raised my hand, went back to the guy who put me in that role to begin with. He had gotten a promotion and at this point was the president of the firm, so that was helpful. And I said, now that you had me do that for 4.5 years, what's keeping you up at night now? What is a problem that you can throw at me? Because if I've done those things, I can do anything. Bring it on. And so he said, without much hesitation, I need you to go figure out our brand. And brand was a word that Goldman had pretty much never used before. Very institutional, B2B kind of business in a way, not consumer oriented, not Main Street focused, and very happy to be, below the radar, not visible, not looking for attention, no logo on the building kind of place. And yet, at that moment in time, it was March of 2010. The financial crisis was looming. But at that point in time, Goldman was still getting credit for having navigated the financial crisis successfully. And what was amazing was when I took the role and I started, I think it was ominously April 1st, a week and a half later was when the SEC filed fraud charges against Goldman. And what started off as a role which was more like, figure out what we should be doing with our brand. And by the way, we're going to add "and digital strategy" to your title because someone has to focus on it and that will ensure that you focus on it. So it was less of a product and services kind of brand and digital selling, because Goldman really didn't have to do that with its stakeholders. It was more about the reputation of the firm and the brand of the firm, which again wasn't like building a brand out of nowhere, which was a brand that was known but about to get incredibly trashed. And so what became initially a kind of interesting opportunity where I'd have to define how I was going to do this role suddenly became a crisis that led to one of the most interesting, in my opinion, brand case studies in crisis that has happened in a while, although there's been some competition, unfortunately. So I am not going to spend this whole talk talking about the Goldman brand case study. If you have questions about that, I'll be happy to answer those questions because, you know, time has passed and there's been stuff written about it, and so I didn't want to assume you knew nothing. Just to continue on my career, however, 4 years of doing that role involved bringing a lot of innovation and new thinking to Goldman, and really having to persuade people to fund and do things and be visible and communicate and transparent and be human in ways that the firm never really had to do so before. And some people really didn't think it was necessary. Some people thought, well, this has nothing to do with our revenues. We don't sell to Main Street. Who cares what Main Street thinks? If you remember that time, it was a time when, you know, I think having Goldman in a headline resulted in 10 times the number of clicks. It was the classic example of what happens when you as a brand do not tell your own story and you watch others tell it for you. And usually it isn't told the way you wished it were told. And so the media coverage of Goldman spiked insanely, and Goldman became a household name in perhaps the most negative way, yet hadn't explained itself, so the media was telling that story. And one other interesting thing to point out was that at that exact time was when digital and social channels started to emerge in a way that brands could partake. And so not only was the media beating up Goldman Sachs, but pretty much anyone who wanted to say anything suddenly had very accessible, long-reach, democratized means of communicating their opinions that could get picked up and shared and cross over into mainstream quite easily. And so it was a very interesting time. During that time, I realized that amidst this disruption, the people I was going to learn most from, and it was this amazing level playing field moment. If you were a veteran marketer, which I was not, suddenly you had to learn about all these new technologies and platforms and ways of measuring things that hadn't really been quantified or measurable before. If you were a newbie like me, you started there and you knew that you had to talk to all of the startups and entrepreneurs who were the ones basically leading that charge. They were the ones you were going to learn the most from. And it was an interesting sort of living contrast for me to be, on the one hand, in crisis mode with a regulatory overhang and a lot of negativity everywhere in ways Goldman hadn't experienced before. And then on the other hand, positive energy, possibility, disruption, and a lot of interesting ideas. And frankly, that kept me sane. And I realized after 4 years in the brand marketing role, when finally it was normal to do a campaign, I didn't have to march around and convince all my partners to do new things and argue with the CFO and all of these things. All of a sudden it was like, okay, what's the next campaign? And I got bored and I realized that I wanted to retire and spend time in the startup world, which is what I do now, advising startups. And one aspect of that that I really love to do is, particularly if I'm meeting media companies or digital companies that have something to do with marketing, is I fundamentally believe that the best way for large companies to innovate is to have that means of a dialogue with all of these startups. Startups are really struggling to find means of access and the right points of communication with big companies. So I try to be a go-between. Obviously, the startup has to be a great company that if I were still a CMO, I would want to do business with. But once meeting that kind of great company, I call some of my CMO friends for whom I know that company's products and services would be relevant. And I say, you know, you should talk to this company. And everybody's happy. It's a great win-win, particularly for the CMO, who often feels like, despite wanting to innovate, they are drinking from a fire hose. How are they going to find these interesting companies? There's really no good mechanism, yet they're being bombarded by all of these emails and solicitations and webinars and what have you in ways that isn't an efficient use of their time. So that's what I spend a lot of my time doing now, and it keeps me sharp and sometimes even keeps me young. But that is sort of a rundown of my career. I think, though, the topics that I want to draw from that to talk about tonight really relate to, one, how all of you work, and two, how you grow. Because stepping out of the fray, I think I have attained some perspective that comes with actually having time to think, and I'd like to share with you some of my discoveries that I hope to apply to any roles that I take forward. But I think that most of all, probably in the room, each of you is somewhat of a change agent. You know, you're trying to convince a lot of people to do new things or do things differently or change their behavior. And you know what? That role is pretty lonely. And that's how I felt a lot when I was in the brand marketing role at Goldman, because it was really just my team that understood the mission. And I didn't have some huge team. We had a small band of warriors. And we each were feeling this profound sense of having to push the boulder up the hill every day. And once we were able to articulate as a team that this role is a change agent role, it is lonely. It's meant to be lonely. But wow, what are the things that we really could accomplish if we take that on? It made me think, as I overheard some conversations today, that while it's supposed to be lonely, how therapeutic it must be for all of you to be together, having had that experience in some way, shape, or form, and rather than have to explain or convince or persuade, actually understand each other's pain. I think that is something that I think over the next day that you're together, you ought to discuss. Because it's not every day that you find yourself in an environment where people can empathize with some of the biggest challenges of your roles. I think that some of the things that I learned relate to the fact that collaboration is more important than ever. There are so many things that are converging. Technology is permeating everything. You can't just grab the flag and run and get things done. There are so many stakeholders. There's so much effort that needs to be spent driving alignment and buy-in that I'm sure is a tremendous use of the energy that you have. So I wanted to share some thoughts on how I experienced that. And then communication is a really, really important part of that. And how often do we actually talk about that topic? I wanted to really share some thoughts on that. In terms of collaboration, especially when you're driving innovation or persuading people to change behaviors and do things differently, share where they haven't before, you're in the middle of a lot of groups, a lot of processes, a lot of data streams, a lot of goals, and it's called the art of influence without authority. And I think that, it's helpful to think of it that way because that's what it is. But taking a step back and really doing an inventory on the relationships that you have and asking yourself, who inside your organization are your clients? And do they know that they're your clients? Everybody likes to be somebody's client. And I think that if you're a salesperson in particular, and by the way, you can be a salesperson by title, or you can be a salesperson because you have to evangelize the change that you're trying to make happen. Everybody wants to be somebody's client. So making someone feel like your client, even though that they're your colleague, or telling them that you think of them as a client, often can change a relationship in a pretty cool way. Then you need to ask yourself, who are your most important clients? Because it's not just a client, who are your most important clients, and do they know how important they are? Who are your stakeholders? And write them down, really thinking about that expansively, because sometimes your stakeholders, as I learned, were compliance and legal and those managing risk and those who have to ultimately approve everything that you do. Typically you look at those stakeholders as the people you want to deal with last, as the people who are going to say no. But if you bring them in early and make them your partners and learn with them, then those could be the greatest enablers of all. You know, I think on that point, probably my first real aha moment as it subsequently related to branding was when I found myself the COO of a business where the branding was, these are the people who are going to say no and prevent you from getting something done. And I thought, well, that's a sucky business model. What if we could change that and say, because we have the expertise that we have, and because we'll get to know you and understand what matters to you and why you want what you do and what's urgent and what's not, we can be invited into the process early. We can be your partners. We can be enablers so that you can get stuff done and get it done more quickly. If you don't think of these people as your stakeholders, you're going to potentially have a problem once you've gotten the ball so far down the field and have done all the work and then encounter the no, because you haven't given those people enough time to think about and understand the change that you are bringing. Asking yourself about your clients and your stakeholders, how they define success, is a very important part of the equation, because often, you know, people will come into the room with their notion of success, but that might have nothing to do with the people you need to have buy into what it is that you need to do together. So asking yourself, are you included in your client's strategic discussion? Are you considered a part of their team? How do you tend to communicate with your clients? How much is in person? How visible are you? One thing that I learned from compliance that subsequently has been relevant to everything, and probably would have been something that I used in my sales role too, was I noticed that when I was talking to a lot of the compliance officers and asking them these questions like a revenue person would about who their clients are and who their relationships were, I found that a lot of them were allowing their relationships to be defined by stressful situations. That is such a bad thing. So imagine from the perspective of a compliance person, the only time you're interacting with the business person is when they have a problem, when it's urgent, and they're in no mood for small talk, where they want you to say yes, and the fact that you're likely to say no is just going to piss them off. They don't want to see you anymore. The notion of actually having a coffee with someone before you have something urgent to discuss, or investing in that relationship so you have a chance to discuss your respective processes so that you can figure out how you can work together or anticipate what shit's gonna hit the fan or how to deal with things when they are stressful. I mean, that is a game changer in terms of relationships. Yet a lot of people allow themselves to be defined by those stressful situations and think that they have relationships and they don't. And most of the time, if you're dealing with business people or whatever stakeholders it is, they're not going to come to you and suggest that. If you go to them and outside of that stressful situation or outside of that formal meeting, you know, enable a discussion, that can really save you so much time and effort and build you buy-in. And lo and behold, you have an ally in the room instead of somebody who's saying, you know, talk to the hand. Thinking about networks is really important because there are all sorts of different kinds of networks. And if you find that the network of people you tend to interact with is very narrow and very similar to you, then what's the likelihood that you're going to get new information? Another very important mechanism, particularly for change agents, particularly related to technology or digital, is to leverage reverse mentoring. And so you might be the driver of that, and then it takes the burden off of you from having to teach, you know, people who might not be digital natives the natively digital things. But most of all, it creates an opportunity for junior people to come and bring expertise that they have and develop relationships for their careers with more senior people who might need to learn these things and are more willing to learn it from a junior person when they feel that there's mentoring around it. So that tends to be an asset to tap into as well when you're driving change. And then, you know, taking a step back and doing an inventory on your own brand, asking yourself, are you seen as a go-to person? And if so, for what? Are you seen as a go-to person for the things you want to be known for or other things? If you think that you're an expert in A, B, C, D, but nobody comes to you to ask questions or get your view on A, B, C, D, like, that's kind of a disconnect. You need to fix that. But the only way you're going to fix that is if you start, you know, putting your antenna up for that kind of thing. Do people come to you for your view, or do they just come to you for help to try to fix something? Who doesn't rely on you when you look at that list of clients and stakeholders? Who should? And what are you going to do about that? And in driving innovation, are you also putting yourself in a position to educate and bring new ideas? A really important part of collaboration is perspective, making what you're trying to change very relevant to the goals and the language of the person that you're trying to get accept that or buy into that. And so, you know, I'll share with you a few stories from my marketing role that, you know, might make you laugh because these platforms are now very commonplace, but actually at the time were, you know, YouTube and Twitter were like completely new and supposedly what the young people were using, but not people who had an opinion of Goldman Sachs. I had to walk into the office of the president of Goldman Sachs and get his approval for launching a YouTube channel. Now, why did Goldman need a YouTube channel? Because there were so many videos about Goldman Sachs out there, none of which were made by Goldman Sachs, all of which were really negative, and they're sitting there for everybody to see. But who goes on YouTube? Ironically, and those of us are probably, most of us in any case, in regulated industries, so you know that certain platforms you can't even access from your desk because they're blocked, because they're two-way, because they're social, because they're meant to be interactive, and compliance and legal only wants things one way, and then those entities look at you like you're crazy. YouTube was one of the few that you could access from your desk at Goldman Sachs. And YouTube was thought of as, you know, a frivolous video site, not the second largest search engine in the world. And so when I came to propose a Goldman YouTube channel, the president of the firm looked at me like I had three heads. And I said, let's go to your desk. The challenge was, how am I going to frame this in a way that he will see why it's important, as opposed to his initial understanding of whatever he thought YouTube was. So we sit down, and I say, pull up YouTube. He didn't even know you could pull it up on your desk. He pulls it up. And of course, all these ridiculous videos appear, which wasn't helpful. I said, there's a search bar. He goes, OK. I said, put Goldman Sachs in the search bar. He said, who's going to search for Goldman Sachs videos? I said, trust me. People are doing this. I have data that proves it. Just put it in there and hit go. What do you think you'll see? He goes, nothing. You know, there are no videos about Goldman Sachs. There were 33,000 videos about Goldman Sachs, none of which, as I said, had been created by Goldman Sachs, 99.9% of which Goldman wouldn't have wanted up on YouTube and accessible. And so when he saw that, we were able to have a different discussion. Because then I was able to say, and this was a really important lesson that I've used over and over and over again, but that was my aha moment for it. You can think of risk as doing something. Usually people associate risk with doing something, but there's actually also risk in not doing something. And unless you talk to someone about what happens if you either don't act, because inaction is also an action, or don't, or purposely decide not to do something, that doesn't mean that it's risk-free. Most people's risk spectrum starts from when you start doing the thing you're proposing to change. And it's sort of like thinking about disruption. You can sit there and not do anything and think that you're not doing risky things, but the fact is not doing some of these innovative things becomes its own risk. And so Goldman's really good at the language of risk. And once I was able to emphasize the risk of not doing being a risk, the risk of not having that YouTube channel allowing anyone to see these horrible videos, to have them come up in the top search results and not be part of that conversation about the brand, as opposed to creating a YouTube channel, starting to create our own content, and enabling our own content as indexed by Google to come up in those search results and at least be part of the conversation. So we couldn't control whether someone was going to click on a Goldman video about Goldman, but we could control whether that was there as an option. And once I was able to present it that way, from his perspective, in the language of risk, which was a language that he was better at than me, all of a sudden, well, oh my gosh, yes, we absolutely need to do a YouTube channel. And so that strategy worked over and over again. I next had to propose launching a Twitter handle. And again, was looked at like I had three heads. Why does Goldman need this? Who's even looking at that? And sometimes crisis creates opportunity. And there was one morning when I woke up and on my way to work, waiting for everybody, was an op-ed that the New York Times decided to publish from an employee who decided to quit, called like Why I Quit Goldman Sachs, and had a very negative article. What company typically needs to deal with a disgruntled employee writing an op-ed that gets published by the New York Times? That in and of itself shows you the need to, you know, make sure that you're managing the conversation about your brand, that that would even be interesting enough to kick out some much more important topics that could have been on that op-ed page was a lesson in and of itself. But the fact was, where did that story get the most traction? In Twitter. People were tweeting like crazy about it. And so this was yet another example of a conversation that we were not in a new channel that we now needed to participate in. So when you talked about the risk of a conversation taking place without your participating in it, lo and behold, it was much easier to launch a Twitter handle, and now Goldman has, I think, at least four. One of the things that also helped relates to a point I made before. And it relates to a bigger point of the spectrum of permission and forgiveness. Now, I've kind of been a rule follower most of my life. That's probably how I ended up in the compliance role and why I fit in quite well, respect the rules, no problem. But similar to, you know, the risk of doing, not doing, being a wider spectrum than you'd naturally think, you can think about things in terms of whether you have permission to do them. But the fact is, for certain things where you feel credible, where you feel expert, and where you feel it's worth the risk, you can do things without asking permission. If you ask permission, you're going to get a yes or a no. And odds are, if you're asking, you might get a no. In certain instances, selectively chosen, if you decide to do things when you feel strongly that it's the right thing to do and risk having to say, I'm sorry, people still respect you for having taken that opportunity. So there was an opportunity to create an advisory board. Because again, when you're a change agent trying to drive buy-in, why not get some of the, you know, senior leaders on your team who cared about the brand, who could help explore these things such that when we were proposing new things, it wasn't just me proposing them. As trusted as I was, as loved as I might have been, I'm one person. And so why not get, you know, a few other people who have a vested interest to add to the voice? Let's create an advisory board. Brilliant idea, made complete sense. People wanted to be on this advisory board. They were contacting me, are you going to have an advisory board? So what do? I go to my boss and I ask permission to have an advisory board. His response is, nobody needs another committee. Nobody has time to have this meeting. You know, yeah, I suppose that would be useful for you, but I think that that's a waste of time for the firm. Nope, sorry. I say no advisory board. Thanks for asking. Okay. Then I realized that I was going to need approvals from all of these folks I mentioned before. There were so many people, given the regulatory environment and given the newness of some of these channels and spaces, that you know, I would have legal, compliance, info security, I would have audit, you name it, procurement. I would have so many people that if I thought about stringing out that process sequentially, I wouldn't live that long. If I thought about even grouping them together once I had formulated my idea, I still could have been stopped in my tracks. And having the unusual good luck of having worked in legal compliance and audit, knowing exactly who I needed to pull together, I created this task force. This task force was all of the approvers and my team who then learned together about all of these channels. Looking at launching a Twitter channel, let's have Twitter come in and let's all learn together, ask all our questions, you know, think about it from every which way of risk, and then get comfortable and then propose it so that when the proposal happened, I already had all my approvals lined up. That ended up being a task force I did not ask for permission to create, which nobody needed credit to be on. They thought that they were really acting in the service of the firm during the crisis. They wanted to learn new things. It was a great experience. They didn't have to be the most senior person. In fact, a lot of them were, you know, VP level people. And it was such a terrific task force that enabled the firm to be as nimble as a regulated firm could be in a crisis. And so that is another way to think about the buy-in that you need. And usually if you're pulling together a group of people like that and they're not the most senior people, et cetera, that's one that falls into the category of, you know, let someone come and yell at you for doing that, you could say, I'm sorry. But usually that works quite well. Another thing that I learned along the way was when you're trying to get people on your side in driving change and innovation, it's really helpful to scan the environment for people who are smart and respected, but also tend to be loud and the type of people that nobody wants to argue with. If you target some of those people and get them on your side, that is like having, you know, a rocket booster tied to your back. And I think that that's a great strategy to consider when you're thinking about who your allies could be. Now, that might take some work up front to convince that tough-to-convince person that they should be on your side. But wow, what an amazing champion they are once they are. Another thing is, you know, when you are dealing with constraints, whether it's a crisis, whether it's regulatory environment, whether it's just volatility, that's when you get your most creative. And I think that point was made at the keynote this afternoon, and I think is a really important point. The last point on this topic that I'll make is another tool in your toolkit is generosity as a mindset. Because if you're on the forefront of things that are innovative, new ideas, ways that you see the future that can help your company, thinking about it in terms of how you can help your colleagues be smarter, how you can be thoughtful about helping them stay on top of change in the industry, usually has a huge ROI. And I think that when you act from a thoughtful, generous place, the goodwill that you get for that is quite unlike most relationship building things. So I'll throw that out there. Communication is such a huge part of collaboration, especially when you're dealing with the double whammy of the very technical language and the finance complexity. I found a TED Talk, which I love. I don't know if any of you have seen it. It's called Talk Nerdy to Me. And it's by Melissa Marshall. And I highly recommend it. It's gotten so many views. But her basic point is it's wonderful to be an expert in very complex things. But that's all that's going to be unless you learn to talk to people who are not expert about it in a way that they can understand. So take the time to think about making numbers easy to understand and relatable and relevant and come to life for that person in the context that matters to them. Think about analogies to use. Use visuals. Draw on a napkin if you have to. But not making that effort leaves you very technical, in your own jargon, with your own acronyms, and the likelihood of being successful is very limited. That said, you should look on your team or look around you at who those people are who have what is really a gift of making the complex simple. There are people who have this gift. Grab them, recruit them, push them out there talking to as many people as possible and recognize them for that skill. Because I've seen so many situations where things don't progress because nobody knows what the other person is talking to. And ultimately, if you're the one trying to get the other person to buy in, it's your problem to meet them where they are. You shouldn't expect them to adapt to your language. You need to put it in theirs. It can't be your agenda. It has to be a shared objective. So you should get feedback as far as how you are at being engaging and exciting, how well you sell. And talk about the importance of this with your teams, because I don't think that that's something that's talked about enough. Everybody is a brand ambassador in this connected era. So how are you equipping people to feel smart about talking about what you're doing and what you're transforming? Because ultimately, this is the future of your organizations, and people really want to be proud that their organization is going to survive and not like be one of those companies on the chart that shows how few of the current Fortune 500 was still on that list as recently as 10 years ago. They want to feel energized. They need to understand those things, and they need to have the talking points. Empathy is a really important piece of the equation. And listening for people's pain points and problems, what keeps them up at night, where others see the risks, so that you can position yourself as solving the problems that matter to them in the way that they see those problems, is really important. So I think I've said enough on collaboration and communication. I think what I just want to add are some things that I've learned, I guess, in whatever you think of the word retirement, but not so immersed in my insane 24/7 life that I used to have that I just didn't have time to think about or notice these things. And I think about this in terms of how we all grow. I ask myself often, how am I keeping my edge? And I challenge you with that question too. What are your sources of information? Where do you discover new things? How diverse is your network in every way? Do you have a discipline of meeting new people? Have you leveraged your network to create new relationships for you? Because you could end up busy, productive, always hair on fire, and not be doing these things, and gradually get less and less good at your job and less on the edge where you need to be and where your company needs you to be. Thinking about your seat as a platform, which is how I described how I learned to look at my career, do you think of it that way? What does it enable for you? How are you using that platform? And whenever you feel frustrated or bored or that you're not learning anymore, take a step back and reframe that platform. What can I do sitting in this seat? Who else can I interact with and do interesting things with or meet or understand better? What are ways I can be more visible externally representing my company? What does the brand I come from enable me to go and do? And you should be constantly reframing your opportunity for growth. I want to share just some thoughts about time, because I've had time to think about time. And I've had control over my time, which is something that I know is a tremendous luxury. It's very easy to get caught up in this notion of being busy, meaning being productive, being scheduled, being back to back, and also thinking about everything as urgent. That's how I was wired, and I have had to spend a lot of time unwiring from that. I have found, as a rule follower, that scheduling unscheduled time and really keeping that sacred, not trading that off, putting in buffers so that you have time to think, is something that I didn't do enough and where I tend to see people not do enough. I really could not emphasize more the importance of experimenting with that, even if it's just once a week, to have your own guarded time to think. What's amazing when you give yourself permission to do that is that actually that's probably when you're going to come up with your best ideas and greatest clarity, and which will enable you to be more proactive about things instead of always trying to be responsive and reactive. Create time to connect the dots. You see a lot of things. How do they connect? Unless you make time to think about it, you're going to miss stuff. Create time to talk with people, to expand your sources of information and exposure, and to develop your networks further. I think that you should have a discipline of meeting at least one new person a week that's out of your usual path and circles, because that person could end up being a tremendous ally of yours or a new source of information for you or access to a relationship. It's very easy to become reactive and not proactive under the guise of being busy. And it's very easy to live a life of telling yourself how productive you are because you're that busy and that everything is urgent versus being prepared, thinking ahead, and taking the time to see around corners. Another thing is that as leaders, taking the time to create time for others to be heard, creating safe spaces so that other people are given the time to think and to share their own ideas. I'll stop there, and you know, I'm happy to take any questions, but I hope that there was at least one thing in all of that that you might take away and think about or put to use. Thank you.
If you were tasked with doing that today, what do you think you'd have to drag the firm kicking and screaming into now?
Huh, that's a great question. I think it's only recently that Goldman launched on Facebook. And I think that that was a very scary channel because there were all sorts of comments. It was, you know, two-way, and that was the only way to do it. But Goldman's done a lot of things that I sort of never thought that Goldman would be okay doing, you know, doing things on Snapchat and other things. So, I'm trying to think what's the craziest thing we could do. I actually think it's more in the business lines because a lot of the first steps that Goldman took in terms of marketing were in the context of overall brand and favorability, not related to a conversion to a product, more a conversion of a mindset. And I think that there are so many opportunities in the high net worth arena where I think Goldman could do more in asset management, where there's an opportunity to do more, and in new businesses that that Goldman is creating. You know, one area that I look at Wall Street and continue to just scratch my head versus all of the ways in which I look at people consume information is, you know, research departments and all of this tremendous content engine known as, you know, equity research that's being produced and still distributed in rather archaic ways versus the targeting that can be done and all of the different channels through which that can travel, and where I think most of the regulatory related hurdles have been dealt with. So I think that that would be more interesting as an opportunity and more tied to actual business products and services than the bigger brand issues and trying to chase the shiny object.
Hey, Lisa.
Yeah, I just want, can you hear me?
Yes, I can even see you.
So the first thing I want to say to one comment is that you're right on about, you know, treating your internal folks as clients, especially in B2B. So we have a retail side in B2B and in financial services, but they have to be your clients. But yeah, I had a question. What was the thought process with Goldman in terms of them going after Main Street with like this new Marcus? What were the gaps they were trying to fill and kind of change the perception of their brand?
So we already had a proprietary brand and reputation research program in place when I showed up to be in my role. And from the moment of that day, which was April 16th of 2010, which most Goldman people can recite for you if they were there because it came as quite a shock, when first that SEC news was announced, shocked everybody, that became major headlines, and often the first way people learned about the Goldman name, followed by, if it transports you back to this time, I remember it vividly, in short order, hearings in which, you know, people were seeing Goldman executives for the first time in the setting of a hearing where, you know, various people in government, Congress, what have you, were peppering them with all sorts of questions that reflected the challenge of explaining complex things in simple, understandable ways. I mean, clearly that was not something that Goldman had been very well versed at. And so I think that those were, you know, very, very big challenges that Goldman needed to address and learn how to communicate that way.
Please join me in thanking Lisa for an absolutely fantastic keynote.